Merry Christmas to all of you. I'm so glad to see all of you here with us. So many guests with us. So glad to see you. And also of you, all of you online, we're glad that you're with us together. If you are online, you might want to get a candle at some point during this service because we will celebrate traditional Christmas Eve with candles, and you might want to have a candle ready for that. For all of us in the room, you should already have your candle with you. And if you don't, they are back where you came in. If you want to grab one there, you're welcome to do that as well. But all of us, would you stand with us right now, whether you're online or here in the room, and let's sing this song together, please. Here we go.
Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod. Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him."
Let's sing together.
Joy to the world.
So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, in the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him, who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And there she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them.
You be seated, please. Let's sing that together.
What child is this who lay to rest? Oh,
So do you have a favorite Christmas album that you listen to every year? There is one song on my favorite Christmas album that I've grown to love more as I have grown older, and it talks about a man who is hiking in the woods on Christmas Eve, and he has a moment of worship when he recognizes how important it is that Christ came to this earth and saved us. And you might know this song. And if you do, you're welcome to sing along with the words that'll be on the screen. If you don't know it, you can listen, or maybe a little bit of both. That would be fine too. But I hope you can worship through this and recognize how much God loves us and the reason that he came to save us.
Frosty Christmas Eve, when the stars were shining, we traveled far the north, where westward falls the hills, and for many, many a village, in the darkness of the valley, distant music reached me, peals of bells were ringing. Then sped my thoughts to olden times, to that first of Christmases, shepherds who were watching heard music. Sat there and they marveled, and they knew they could not tell where the winds were angels, the bright stars were singing. But soon we heard afar, it was starry music singing. as I stood upon the hill.
Amen. The only part I don't like about that song is when he says that the shepherds could not tell whether it were angels or the bright stars were singing, because I think the Bible is pretty clear. There was an army of heaven that was proclaiming Jesus' birth, and that's what this song, last song that we're going to sing together, talks about. So I invite you to sing this with me. And there may be a song, for those of you who are guests with us, this church has become a church that likes to stand up during worship unprompted by me. And I am all about that. I think it's great that that happens. So if there's a part in this song where you want to stand up and I didn't tell you to stand up, that's okay. That's an okay thing to do. Let's worship together and sing this song together, please.
Holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till He appeared and the soul felt His worth. The thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for
Christmas present I probably got was socks.
Clothes.
A pencil?
A little small stuffed animal?
I don't really think I got a bad Christmas gift ever. I think I've gotten everything I really wanted.
The worst Christmas present I've ever got is probably a blue robot because it runs out of battery like 3 days it's out of battery.
You like forgiveness or?
Gold, silver, and clothes.
Gold, silver, myrrh,
gold, Frankenstein.
Gold, boysenberry, escape.
Gold, and murder, and Lumar, I think.
Bethlehem, I think.
Bethlehem.
Bethlehem.
Bethlehem?
Dallas? I think Jesus did.
Joseph.
Gabriel the angel came and told her.
'Cause there was an angel that told her.
I think God told her.
An angel.
The spirits told her.
Like in Pocahontas.
Que, que, natura, you will understand.
George.
King Arthur.
Goliath.
Henry. Joshua.
Bethlehem.
Herod.
So what was the worst Christmas gift you ever received? I was going to say socks, but that's already taken, apparently. I was thinking, though, why would we ever ask that question? I mean, Christmas isn't a time about the worst. Christmas is a time about the best and how Christmas brings the best out of all of us. It's this time of year where we're reminded of God coming to be with us, and we celebrate that reality. And maybe some of the actual details of the story, like King Goliath, gets in your way. But ultimately, we realize it's all about him blessing us. Blessing us when we really didn't deserve it. And Christmas has too much joy to focus on the worst. Or, wait a minute, does it? Maybe that's exactly what we might want to focus on so that we can see that he came to be with us to fill us with great joy. Now, let's hear it again from Luke chapter 2. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord." Now, we often talk about angels being these terrifying beings, and they actually were. And the first one shows up, Gabriel, and he appears to these shepherds, and the whole field is filled with light from that one angel. Imagine then when the whole host of angels, as Pastor Phil told us earlier, showed up. And the brightness of that moment, the glory of that moment that crashed through all of the darkness, not only of the night, but of the society in which they ultimately would be announcing it to. This is the message of joy that has been lost because we don't remember how dark it really was. But this is the thing about the story. Joy is often the greatest when the situation is the darkest. When we're going through the most difficult time and then something comes to rescue us or relieve us or help us, That's when joy is the greatest. We started the With Us series talking about the prophet's message to the people. And hundreds of years before Jesus ever came to the earth, it was super dark. There was a lot of violence, a lot of oppression, a lot of pain, and a lot of suffering that the Israelites brought on themselves with their own rebellion against a God who loved them so much. And so the prophet gave them hope that turning back to him would bring blessing and honor, and one was coming to help them through that. But in the midst of it all, families were living in poverty, in fear, with questions about their future and not knowing if they were going to live another day or find food for another day or be hurt by someone on another day. Well, let me remind you what Isaiah said to his people hundreds of years before Jesus came. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light, and on those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. Hundreds of years before he came, Isaiah's telling the people this prophecy would be fulfilled, and he was talking about Jesus' birth. Matthew, in his gospel, actually records this prophecy and says, Jesus is absolutely the fulfillment of this light that Isaiah said was coming into the darkness that had overtaken the people. You see, because without him, without God, without his blessing, without his salvation in your life, really, when you think about it, somewhere out there at the end of your road is darkness and suffering and death. Now, I have to be honest with you. This is going to probably sound a little bit strange to you, but I've come to appreciate the mess that evolves when we're opening our Christmas presents at our house. Now, I have family members on the front row, and they're shocked right now to hear that, because I'm usually the one with the garbage bag, picking it all up, putting it in there, trying to keep it all neat as we're opening everything. I mean, because, you know, we don't want to let the world know that we actually leave messes at Christmas. And yet, I think it was last year, as I'm cleaning it all up, I began to think to myself, next year, I'm going to leave the mess for a while, because the mess is what it's all about. See, we have a lot of metaphors at Christmas, don't we? We have the gifts, which are to represent the gift of salvation that God's given us in Jesus. We have the trees that talk about this life-giving salvation that he provides and the celebration that goes with it when we decorate the tree. We have the lights twinkling, reminding us of the star that appeared over Bethlehem to guide the kings to him to bring their gifts. We have all of these analogies, these metaphors of Christmas, and I'm deciding that my favorite one now for the rest of my life will be the mess. The mess. Because when it's all said and done, Christmas was all about the mess. The mess that's going on in our hearts, the mess that's going on in the world, the struggle, the suffering, the pain of a broken, fallen, rebellious world. That's why he came to be with us. And that's why the angels sang, "Joy is coming to the world." Because in the moments of darkness is where his light shines the brightest. You see, we sing joy to the world. The Lord is come because of the reality that who he is ultimately cleans up the messes of our lives. All the darkness in our world, even today, is dispelled by the hope that comes from Jesus being with us. We still sing for joy today. This joy will still be for all people in the world, because he's come to invade the darkness with his light. And the ultimate darkness, death, has been defeated by his death on the cross. And so I'm leaving the paper. I'm sorry, honey, just for a little while at least. And we're going to remember that's what we celebrate. But let's read it again, because we really want to get it here. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord." You see, that's what he wants you to understand about his joy. It's joy that Christmas offers you. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. He is Christ the Lord. Now, it's interesting. I found this out recently. In the United Arab Emirates, they have a minister of happiness. It's an actual cabinet position for their king. A minister of happiness. And their whole role is to develop government programs that will help increase the happiness of the people in their nation. Minister of happiness. Maybe we should get one of those. Secretary of happiness. I just like to think of myself as Pastor Happiness. You know, can we actually legislate happiness? You know, it's interesting. Even our Constitution says that we have the rights that we have to what? Pursue happiness. And if we're honest, if we really admit the truth inside us, that's really what we're going for in our lives. We pursue it in various ways, and institutions in our society all try to help us find it, whether it's education or government or business or even the family. These are all institutions that try to help us find the happiness that we're all in pursuit of. Here's the thing. No matter how much happiness I have in my life, no matter how much happiness you have in your life, it's all going to end the same way. It's all going to end with some sadness. Some sadness for somebody. Because in the end, the great equalizer, no matter what your status is, no matter what kind of leadership, what kind of education, no matter what kind of income you have, no matter your position or title, everybody will experience death. And yet that's why he offers us joy. Joy is something so much deeper than happiness. I mean, I want to be happy. You want to be happy? But I want to be so much more than happy. Because I want to know when that great, great equalizer comes, death, no matter when it is, an hour from now or decades from now, I want to know inside my heart that I have this promise of eternal life. Amen. And that's what his coming offers to you. Christmas offers you the joy that comes when even though you're facing real difficulties, and he never promised that we wouldn't face trials and struggles and pain, suffering, and difficulties. But even in the midst of all of those, we can be sure because of his promise at Christmas that he has come to the world to give you eternal life. It's Christmas's offer to you. Because unto you is born this day in the city of David, a Savior. He is Christ. He is Christ, your Lord. If you receive that offer of his joy, and that's why more than anything else with us brings us great joy. So when we sing the carol, Joy to the World, as we did a little earlier, it has a whole new depth of meaning for those who've experienced this relationship with God, this acceptance of the reality of his coming and the promise of his coming, that you too can know you don't have to fear death and the grave. Joy is the depth of happiness that allows you and enables you and equips you and empowers you to trust God in your darkest of days. Now, I think about the dark days that he comes to bring his light to. And honestly, you know, I started thinking, you know, how do you illustrate this? And yet I look around this room this afternoon. I think of those of you even who are with us online. and you could begin to tell me the stories of your own dark days. You could tell me stories of illness. You could tell me stories of brokenness. You could tell me stories of struggles in relationships in your family. You could tell me all of the stories of your darkest days, and I want you to know that's why he came to be with us, why he came to be with you, is to help you understand that those days aren't the end. Those days he will walk with you through and give you help and strength to face them. Because when the darkness seems all-consuming, he crashes through it with this powerful light, these angelic beings who come with the message, not the angels themselves, but the message they proclaimed, that this one has offered you great joy, even in your darkest moments. And, you know, maybe you're staring at a mess right now, and I'm not talking about the wrapping paper from your Christmas gifts. Maybe you're staring at a mess right now in some relationships or some diagnosis or some financial struggle. Maybe you're dealing with a mess right now that you know is going on right inside your own heart, and you don't know how to deal with it. This is why he came, to offer you help, to offer you hope, to offer you guidance, to offer you joy. Great, abounding, deeply seated joy. The question is, will you choose it? Will you receive it for yourself? I mean, we can sing about it, and you can accept the invitation to come to a Christmas celebration like this and hear about it, but it all boils down to the angels of heaven and Jesus himself readily handing you this promise. And the question is, will you receive it? Will you bring the hope and joy of Christmas into your heart? Will you allow him to be with you? Now, that is something that we always do here at Southland as we come to the end of a challenge from the scripture or the story of the gospel. And we always ask the question, what are you going to do with this? I mean, seriously, when it's all said and done at the end of a service here at Southland, the question is, so what? I mean, so what? Whatever you just told me there, so what? What am I supposed to do with that? And that's the beauty of this. He offers you joy. And simply by faith and receiving his great grace, you can know that all that you failed at, all that you've sinned at, is forgiven. And you can know that he gives you a fresh start when you believe and receive his truth and his joy. So I'd like to invite everyone to bow your head, and this is a moment just between you and the God who made you. This is a moment between you and Jesus. And you reply, you respond. And maybe you need help with that. I don't know how to pray, I don't know what to say. I'll help you. Maybe it's something like this. You can pray it. Lord Jesus, I want your joy. Help me to believe and help me to receive and help me to walk this road trusting you. Thank you, Jesus, for being with me. Now help me, Jesus, to walk with you. In your beautiful name, I pray. Listen, if that's a prayer that you've prayed tonight, you can be sure, because his promise is in his word, that anyone who's received him has become his child. Anyone who embraces this reality and receives his grace and forgiveness is offered this joy and hope, and you can know that that gift of Christmas is yours. And we just want to help you grow in that understanding. That's why we're here every week. We're going to be back here tomorrow at 10 o'clock. all because we've got a lot of joy and we've got a lot to celebrate because the light has dispelled the darkness. And that's why I think it's so beautiful when I think of Isaiah's prophecy that the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. And that's why I love the metaphor of the light. Because more than anything, this reminds us of the love of Christ. A light exposes oftentimes the things that are hiding in the darkness, right? I mean, you can flip it on, and if you got bad stuff happening underneath your floors, it's going to show up when the light comes on. And if you got something hidden, when the light comes on, he's going to show you. But that's the beauty of it. It's when he turns on the light, he offers you the hope that comes with it. And so at Christmas Eve, we light candles to remind us that those who were walking in darkness have now seen a great light. And you can receive that light and you can share that light with the world. And so our staff and their families and our families are going to come through the auditorium. We're going to light candles and you're going to pass it on to the person next to you. Listen, hey, help us. The one who's got the lit candle, keep it straight up and down. We're only sharing the light, not the wax. But in doing that, as you look at it, first enjoy the light for yourself. But then as you pass it on, enjoy the privilege of giving it away to someone else. And let's sing together and be reminded of that night when joy came to the world.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child. Thank you.
together, please.
Now it's your light. It's your light to allow to glow within you, and it's your light to share with someone else. I'll be honest, I love singing that song, but we all know that the night really wasn't that silent. There was a lot of chaos going on then. There's a lot of chaos going on now. But we have this privilege, because he lives in us, to be that light. At Christmas, Christ the Savior is born. The people in living in darkness have now seen a great light. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for the gift that you are this Christmas. We celebrate your goodness, and we celebrate your great salvation. We pray for those in this space and with us online who have found you tonight. They have found help. They have found hope. They have found joy. And we pray, oh God, that now you will use all of us to share this wonderful message of joy with everyone you put in our path. And we'll thank you for the privilege of doing it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now listen, before you go, every Christmas Eve, those who bring offerings, we just want to tell you, all the offering that comes in tonight goes to our benevolence fund. We've been helping people through very difficult times, especially in the last month. So if you have an offering, we have offering boxes on the walls before you get out of this room right near the doors. You can just drop an offering in there. All 100% of it will go to our benevolence funds so that we can help people in need. And so I'll probably be quoting all of the children in the room here. When I say, first of all, Merry Christmas from all of us, our staff and our families. Merry Christmas to all of you. We love you and appreciate you so much. But to quote the kids, let's get out of here. God bless you. Merry Christmas, everyone.